The world watched in awe on July 20, 1969, as Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin took humanity's first steps on the lunar surface.
Armstrong is on the moon. Neil Armstrong, 38-year-old American, standing on the surface of the moon.
Just under 7 years prior, President John F. Kennedy made his famous speech at Rice University.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
But what would become of the Apollo program now that its main objectives had been achieved?
I don't know what happened here. We had everything in the world drop out. We got three fuel cell lights, an AC bus light, a fuel cell disconnect, AC bus overload 1 and 2, main bus A and B out.
Stay tuned as we delve into the Apollo 12 mission and discover what happened in the following chapters of lunar exploration here on Elder Fox. In the latter stages of the Second World War, it became apparent that the inevitably victorious Allied powers would lead the world into a new era. However, this would not be harmonious. Ideological differences caused the temporary alliance to split, with the Soviet Union and its communist allies forming one faction in the East, and the United States and its capitalist allies forming another in the West. These two rising superpowers would soon be vying for global influence, and the top brass on both sides knew it. With the United States emerging relatively unscathed from the terrors of war on home soil, their focus was now on building up a technological advantage over the Soviet Union. The United States knew it could not compete with the sheer size of the Red Army, so a quality over quantity approach was instated. The balance of power was already very much in the U.S.'s favor on this front, with the USA possessing the world's only nuclear arsenal. Furthermore, unlike the Soviet Union, the United States would not have to spend time and manpower on rebuilding the post-war country, meaning that the full attention of its mighty industry could be diverted to technological advancement. Germany had taken a similar quality over quantity stance in the final years of the Second World War, with the intuitive designs of fighter jet aircraft and rocket-propelled V-weapons being just a few examples of this. America had taken note and set in motion a plan to capture the German scientists behind the technology as the U.S. Army swept through Europe. The U.S. was betting that the captured scientific minds would one day give them an edge in a future conflict with the USSR, and so Operation Paperclip was put into force. Officially approved by President Truman on September 3, 1946, Operation Paperclip planned to recruit the smartest and brightest of Germany's technological minds into the employ of the United States. Initially, a list of around 4,000 scientists, engineers, and technicians was drawn up by U.S. Army Major Robert B. Staver. The majority of these had worked on the V-2 rocket team for Germany, putting them among the most knowledgeable rocketry minds in the world. Operation Paperclip would go on to recruit more than 1,600 Germans. These included Kurt Debus, a former V-2 rocket scientist who became a NASA director, seen here sitting between President John F. Kennedy and Vice President Lyndon B. Johnson, and perhaps most notably, Wernher von Braun, chief architect of the Saturn V super heavy lift launch vehicle. Born in the small town of Wierzyce, in what is now modern-day Poland, Wernher von Braun was the leading figure in the development of rocket technology in World War II-era Germany. He helped design and co-develop the V-2 rocket, leading him to become a top priority target for Operation Paperclip. After surrendering to American infantrymen on May 2, 1945, von Braun and his specialists were secretly transferred to the United States, where they developed rocket technology that launched the United States' first space satellite, Explorer 1. In 1960, his group was merged into NASA, where he served as director of the newly formed Marshall Space Flight Center, which began the developmental work on the largest rockets the world had ever seen. In contrast to Operation Paperclip, the Soviet Union conducted a comparable operation which relocated more than 2,200 German specialists during one night on October 22, 1946. This helped to give the USSR an early advantage in the space race. The first satellite, Sputnik 1, was launched by the Soviets on October 4, 1957, almost 4 months before the American-made Explorer 1 was launched. Although this was a major scientific achievement, both sides had now shown their capability to produce and launch intercontinental ballistic missiles, inching the threat of nuclear war ever closer. The USSR then sent the dog Laika into orbit aboard Sputnik 2 on November 3, 1957, followed by two more dogs in 1960, which were safely returned to Earth. The U.S. could only achieve this feat years later in January 1961, when a chimpanzee named Ham was launched on the Mercury Redstone 2 mission. Then, the big one. Cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin became the first man in space on April 12, 1961. The USSR surprised the world by launching Yuri into a single orbit around the Earth in a craft they called Vostok 1, in the process making him a national hero. Just under a month later, Alan Shepard became the first American in space on May 5, 1961. Clearly, the United States was still behind in the space race, meaning a new, bold step needed to be taken.
We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
So the objective of putting a man on the moon had been set, but getting there was by no means an easy task. It had only been a year since the first American was launched into space when President Kennedy made his pivotal speech, meaning NASA was required to quickly learn how to run in a world where it had just started walking. Named after the Greek god of light, music, and the sun, the Apollo program was conceived to achieve Kennedy's goal. It had been identified that a three-man team would be needed for a lunar mission, with two of those crew descending to the lunar surface while the other waited to rendezvous in lunar orbit. So far, NASA only had spacecraft capable of launching a single person into space, and so Project Gemini was conceived to bridge the technological gap required for the Apollo missions. With a crew of two, the Gemini spacecraft aimed to develop space travel techniques to support the Apollo mission to land astronauts on the moon. In doing so, it allowed the United States to catch up and overcome the lead in human spaceflight capability the Soviet Union had obtained in the early years of the space race by demonstrating mission endurance up to just under 14 days, longer than the 8 days required for a round trip to the moon. Methods of performing extravehicular activity, otherwise known as EVAs, and the orbital maneuvers necessary to achieve rendezvous and docking with another spacecraft. This left the Apollo program free to pursue its prime mission without spending precious time and resources developing these techniques. With the kinks of the program being ironed out by the findings of Project Gemini, NASA now required the world's first super heavy lift launch vehicle. Enter Wernher von Braun. Von Braun and his team at the Marshall Center were tasked with the creation of the Saturn V rockets to carry heavy payloads into and beyond Earth orbit. The three-stage rocket remains to this day the tallest, heaviest, and most powerful rocket ever brought to operational status, and holds the record for the heaviest payload launched into space at a staggering 140 metric tons, or roughly 90 average-sized cars. With the concurrent design and production of the command modules and lunar landers, the program was ready to launch its first crewed mission in 1967. Apollo 1 was geared up and a few weeks from launching on January 27, 1967. But then disaster struck. While conducting a routine launch rehearsal, astronauts Gus Grissom, Edward White, and Roger Chaffee all perished atop a Saturn rocket when an electrical fire broke out, engulfing the command module in flames. Consequently, all crewed missions were suspended for 20 months while the command module's hazards were addressed. NASA was in shock. The Apollo 1 crew had paid the highest price for the advancement of space exploration. Not to be deterred, unmanned tests continued, and on October 11, 1968, Apollo 7 was primed and ready to take the next step towards the moon landing. At 11:02 a.m., the first crewed Apollo mission lifted off, going on to extensively test the command module in Earth orbit over a 10-day period. Notably, the Apollo 7 transmitted the first live television broadcast aboard a crewed American spacecraft, seen here asking viewers to keep those cards and letters coming in, folks. Now that the spaceworthiness of the Apollo spacecraft had been certified, NASA could enter the next phase of space exploration by sending man further than ever before. Apollo 8 launched on December 21, 1968. Its mission? To go to the moon. In doing so, Apollo 8 would become the first crewed spacecraft to leave low Earth orbit, and so the first human spaceflight to reach another astronomical object. The aim of the mission was to successfully reach and orbit the moon, an objective reflected in the design of the mission patch. The three astronauts for the mission, Frank Borman, James Lovell, and William Anders, were the first humans to witness and photograph an Earthrise, and also snapped the first image of Earth in its entirety taken by a human. Apollo 9 and 10 would follow, testing essential systems to be used on the lunar surface. Apollo 10 was to be a dress rehearsal for the first landing, with the lunar module descending to just 50,000 feet from the lunar surface. Along their way, the crew of Apollo 10 became the fastest traveling human beings of all time, reaching a top speed of 24,791 miles per hour, a record which still stands to this day. These missions all went as planned and paved the way for the final step towards realizing President Kennedy's objective set in 1962, putting a man on the moon. On July 20, 1969, the world watched in awe as history was made. An estimated 652 million people tuned in to watch the live global broadcast of the Apollo 11 moon landing, setting a then record for the most watched television event of all time, despite the fact that the moonwalk took place in the middle of the night across Europe. Just 4 days previously, the mission launched from Cape Canaveral, Florida, and began its journey of 230,000 nautical miles to the moon. En route, the transposition, docking, and extraction maneuver was performed, whereby the command module Columbia was attached to the lunar module Eagle. After arriving in lunar orbit, Mission Commander Neil Armstrong and Lunar Module Pilot Buzz Aldrin began their descent to the lunar surface in Eagle, leaving Command Module Pilot Michael Collins alone aboard Columbia. Eagle entered the landing phase of the mission with a higher-than-anticipated velocity, meaning the targeted landing site was now miles out of reach. Armstrong quickly reacted to this and took semi-automatic control of the module. After sighting a clear patch of ground nearby, Armstrong directed the craft towards it. With only seconds of fuel remaining before an aborted landing, the module touched down. What came next was etched into the minds of a generation and is one of the most monumental moments in human history. Once on the lunar surface, the flag of the United States was planted, with Aldrin remarking, "Of all the jobs I had to do on the moon, the one I wanted to go the smoothest was the flag raising." Minutes later, the crew received a call from the president, which Nixon called the most historic phone call ever made from the White House. All in all, during the 2.5-hour EVA, 21.5 kilograms of samples were collected. Mirrors were placed for the lunar laser ranging experiment, and Aldrin had snapped a photo of his boot print as part of an experiment to test the properties of the lunar soil. The milestone of putting a man on the moon had been achieved, but Kennedy's goal of bringing him back safely still remained in the balance. This didn't get off to the smoothest of starts. While still on the lunar surface, Aldrin accidentally damaged the circuit breaker that would arm the main engine for liftoff. There was a concern this would prevent firing the engine, stranding the men on the moon. Both men improvised, and a felt-tip pin was sufficient enough to activate the engine switch, blasting them off back towards the orbiting Collins. While the two modules rendezvoused, Collins snapped this image of the lunar module, which Armstrong and Aldrin were inside. Behind them is an Earthrise over the moon. The photo has become known as everyone in the world except Michael Collins. After docking, the command module began its long journey back to Earth and prepared for re-entry above the Pacific Ocean. In the closing stages of the mission on July 24th, the recovery area was changed at short notice due to bad weather, meaning an altered flight plan was required. A different sequence of computer programs was used, one never before attempted, and the astronauts were subjected to forces of up to 6.5 Gs. Fortunately, splashdown went as planned, and the crew was collected by specialist divers aboard Sea King helicopters from the USS Hornet. The Apollo 11 crew had landed back on Earth and into the pages of history. But there wouldn't be an immediate fanfare for the space race heroes, because NASA scientists had small but significant concerns about a possible, quote, moon plague. The Apollo 11 crew was quarantined almost immediately after they emerged from the command module Columbia. During this period, the astronauts would take up residence in the mobile quarantine facility while aboard the USS Hornet, seen here. President Nixon greeted the astronauts while they were still in the MQF, telling them, "As a result of what you've done, the world has never been closer together before." The Hornet returned to Pearl Harbor, where the MQF was loaded onto a Lockheed C-141 Starlifter and airlifted to the Manned Spacecraft Center, where the astronauts could be transferred to the Lunar Receiving Laboratory to complete their quarantine. After 21 days since the last contact with the lunar surface, Armstrong, Aldrin, and Collins could finally step into the open air, and so the Apollo 11 mission was complete. But what now? What would be America's and the world's next step towards exploring the cosmos? Apollo 12 would continue the moon mission, once again putting boots on lunar soil. On the morning of November 14, 1969, the Apollo 12 mission was ready and waiting to launch from Cape Canaveral, Florida. Earlier that day, American astronauts Pete Conrad, Alan Bean, and Richard Gordon had all climbed atop one of Von Braun's mighty Saturn V rockets and prepared themselves to be blasted off towards the moon. However, as the launch approached, a thunderstorm began to creep in over the Kennedy Space Center. NASA forecasters had been expecting this, but no one had planned for what happened next. 36.5 seconds after liftoff, lightning struck the ferocious rocket not once, but twice. So, what did this mean for the mission? Could it go ahead as planned? Just 4 months after Neil Armstrong's monumental first steps on the moon, the United States and NASA were ready to send astronauts back to the lunar surface. Now that the spotlight was less on achieving the astounding feat of putting a man on the moon, areas of more scientific interest would play a bigger role in the selection process of a new lunar landing site. NASA Planning Coordinator Jack Sevier and his team argued for a landing close enough to the crater in which the Surveyor 3 probe had landed in 1967, which would allow the astronauts to cut parts from it and return them to Earth. However, there were strong reservations around attempting such a pinpoint landing by some within NASA, partly due to fears of a lack of landing accuracy, as had been the case with Apollo 11. Setting the pinpoint landing as an objective and then missing it could be seen as a failure by the international community and an embarrassment to the United States space program. Despite this, what became known as the Surveyor Crater was selected as the primary landing site for the Apollo 12 mission. The mission insignia featured a design paying homage to the crew's naval background. All three astronauts at the time of the mission were U.S. Navy commanders. The patch has four stars on it, one each for the three astronauts who flew the mission, and one for Clifton Williams, the original lunar module pilot for the mission who was killed in 1967. The star was placed there at the suggestion of his replacement, Alan Bean. Each crew member was put through a vigorous training schedule totaling more than 1,000 hours, while NASA engineers worked tirelessly to assemble the Apollo 12 spacecraft. Had Apollo 11 not succeeded in putting a man on the moon, Apollo 12 would have flown in September 1969, just 2 months after the Apollo 11. This was to ensure that America would be the first nation to reach the moonwalk milestone in the space race. With the successful landing on the moon in July 1969, however, the Apollo 12 mission was given more breathing room, allowing it to be pushed back to a later date in November of the same year, although this wasn't without consequence. After years of planning, the Apollo 12 mission finally launched on the dreary morning of Friday, November 14th at 11:22 a.m. As President Nixon watched on from the cover of his umbrella, the Saturn V rocket blasted off, experiencing winds of up to 174.6 miles per hour during its ascent, the strongest of any Apollo mission. These winds were not unusual for the time of year, as the launch date coincided with the tail end of the Atlantic hurricane season. Nonetheless, NASA still had its reservations about conducting a launch in such conditions. There was a NASA rule against launching into a cumulonimbus cloud, which were present on launch day. However, this rule would be waived, as launching at a later date would mean the mission would miss out on a landing at the Surveyor Crater. Within the first minute of the Apollo 12 mission, disaster struck. Lightning hit the Saturn V 36.5 seconds after liftoff, causing a voltage surge that knocked all three fuel cells offline, meaning the spacecraft was being powered entirely from its batteries, which could not supply enough amperage to meet demand. A second strike at 52 seconds knocked out the 8-ball attitude indicator. The telemetry stream at Mission Control was garbled, but the Saturn V continued to fly normally. The strikes had fortunately not affected the Saturn V instrument unit guidance system, which functioned independently from other electronics. The astronauts, unexpectedly, had a board red with caution and warning lights, but could not tell exactly what was wrong. The electrical, environmental, and consumables manager in Mission Control, John Aaron, remembered the telemetry failure pattern from an earlier test when a power loss caused a similar malfunction. Aaron made a call. Flight, EECOM, try SCE to AUX. This instructed the crew to switch the electronics to a backup power supply. The switch was fairly obscure, with none of the main commanders at Mission Control knowing what it was. Bean, however, who was the spacecraft's engineer, knew exactly where to find it and immediately threw the switch, after which the telemetry came back online, revealing no significant malfunctions. Bean then put the fuel cells back online, and the mission continued. Once in an Earth parking orbit, the crew carefully checked out their spacecraft before reigniting the third stage rockets for translunar injection. Back at Mission Control, it was initially feared that the lightning strike could have damaged the explosive bolts that opened the command module's parachute compartment. The decision was made not to share this with the astronauts and to continue with the flight plan, since they would die if the parachutes failed to deploy, whether following an Earth orbit abort or upon return from the moon, so nothing was to be gained by aborting. Thankfully, the parachutes deployed and functioned normally at the end of the mission, confirming that the lightning strikes caused no serious permanent damage. For his role in those frightful moments on November 14, 1969, John Aaron was widely credited with saving the Apollo 12 and would later go on to playing an important role during the Apollo 13 crisis. The next few stages of the mission were performed with great caution due to the lightning strikes. Conrad and Bean entered the lunar module on the first day of the flight to check its status, earlier than planned. They found no issues with it, or with the remainder of the onboard instruments. Luckily, the spacecraft had survived its encounter with the lightning-filled skies over Florida, but the mission was far from over. After traveling 230,000 miles to reach the moon, Conrad and Bean entered the lunar module Intrepid and began their preparations for the lunar descent. Pete Conrad had trained to expect a pattern of craters known as the Snowman to be visible when the craft underwent the pitchover maneuver and managed to successfully set down the lunar lander near the Surveyor crater, just 535 feet away from the Surveyor probe itself. Although the landing had been rougher than expected, it had demonstrated America's ability to make a pinpoint landing on another celestial body, with the landing spot appropriately dubbed Pete's parking lot. When Conrad, the shortest man of the initial group of astronauts, stepped onto the lunar surface, his first words were, "Whoopee! Man, that may have been a small one for Neil, but that's a long one for me." This was not an off-the-cuff remark. Conrad had made a $500 bet with a reporter to say these words. After they questioned whether NASA had instructed Neil Armstrong to say his famous first words as he stepped onto the moon, Conrad later said he was never able to collect the money, despite holding up his end of the bet. Unlike the monochrome camera used for television coverage of the Apollo 11 landing, Apollo 12 carried a color camera. While setting up the camera, Bean accidentally pointed it directly into the sun, destroying the SEC tube inside. Television coverage of the mission was thus terminated almost immediately, creating the solar system's first lunar blooper. After raising a U.S. flag on the moon, Conrad and Bean spent the remainder of the mission collecting several pieces of the Surveyor probe, as well as 33 kilograms of moon rock samples, some of which were found to be 810 million years old. Intrepid lifted off from the moon 143 hours into the mission on November 20, 1969, and rendezvoused back with Gordon in the command module. The crew stayed another day in lunar orbit, taking photographs of the surface, which would later be used to identify candidate sites for future Apollo landings. After performing the trans-Earth injection burn, the crew were homebound. During this time, a solar eclipse was caught on camera when the Earth came between the spacecraft and the sun. Bean described this event as the most spectacular sight of the mission. The mission returned to Earth 10 days after its launch, splashing down in the Pacific Ocean on November 24, 1969, bringing home all three astronauts in relatively good shape. The landing was hard, and a camera was dislodged, striking Bean in the head. After recovery by the USS Hornet, the crew entered the mobile quarantine facility, following the same isolation procedure as the Apollo 11 mission. This process would be used one final time during the Apollo 14 mission, after which there was sufficient evidence to suggest that matter from the lunar surface was not harmful to life on Earth, and that there was no possibility of a so-called lunar plague. After the Apollo 12 mission, Conrad urged his crewmates to join him in the Skylab program, seeing it as the best chance of flying in space again. Bean did so. Conrad commanded Skylab 2, the first crewed mission to the space station, while Bean commanded Skylab 3. Gordon, though, still hoped to walk on the moon and remained with the Apollo program, serving as backup commander of Apollo 15. After the moon landing's mission, officials from the Soviet Union said landing humans on the moon was dangerous and unnecessary. At the time, the Soviet Union was attempting to retrieve lunar samples robotically. The Soviets publicly denied there was a race to the moon and indicated they were not trying to do so. Instead, the Soviets said in July 1969, "We are concentrating wholly on the creation of large satellite systems." It was revealed in 1989 that the Soviets had, however, tried to send people to the moon but were unable to do so due to technological difficulties. They had developed the N1 rocket, the Soviet counterpart to the Saturn V, which to this day remains the most powerful rocket stage ever built. However, the project was underfunded and rushed, with development only starting in October 1965, almost 4 years after the Saturn V. Each of the four attempts to launch an N1 failed, with the second attempt resulting in the vehicle crashing back onto its launch pad shortly after liftoff, causing one of the largest artificial non-nuclear explosions in human history. This marked a significant turning point in the space race, as the United States now held a clear advantage in rocket technology. Of the remaining moon missions, Apollo 13 is the most well-remembered in the general public's mind. The doomed mission launched April 11, 1970, just under 5 months after the Apollo 12 launch. However, disaster struck 2 days into the mission when an oxygen tank failed in the service module. This meant that the planned lunar landing could not go ahead and left the fate of the crew in balance. Without oxygen, needed for breathing and for generating electrical power, the service module's propulsion and life support systems could not operate. Astronauts Jim Lovell, Jack Swigert, and Fred Hayes transferred to the lunar module for use as a sort of lifeboat, as the command module's resources were conserved for re-entry. After looping round the moon, improvisations were made to get the carbon dioxide scrubber system working correctly, and the mission began its return to Earth. When the service module was jettisoned, this photo was snapped, showing the extent of the damage. Fortunately, the crew splashed down back on Earth alive, with the mission labeled as a successful failure. The crew experienced great hardship over the duration of the mission, caused by limited power, a chilly, wet cabin, and a shortage of water. Because of this, there was renewed public interest in the Apollo program, with tens of millions watching the splashdown in the South Pacific Ocean live on television. After the dramatic mission of Apollo 13, Apollo 14 launched on January 31, 1971. The launch was originally scheduled for 1970, but was postponed because of the investigation following the failure of Apollo 13. Commanded by Alan Shepard, the first American in space, Apollo 14 is perhaps best remembered for Shepard hitting two golf balls he had brought with him with a makeshift club. While in lunar orbit, command module pilot Stuart Roosa performed numerous scientific experiments, some with several hundred seeds. Upon return to Earth, the seeds were germinated, resulting in the so-called moon trees. These were widely distributed in the years following the mission. Apollo 15 introduced the lunar roving vehicle to the moon program, otherwise known as the moon buggy. The concept of a lunar rover predated the Apollo missions, with a 1952 article by von Braun suggesting such a vehicle could be used for lunar exploration. The lunar roving vehicle program vastly increased the Apollo astronauts' lunar range and came in at a cost of $38 million for four moon buggies. Adjusted for inflation, each moon buggy cost $62.5 million, making them some of the most expensive four-wheeled vehicles ever produced. While on the lunar surface, Commander David Scott demonstrated Galileo's theory that all objects in a given gravity field fall at the same rate, regardless of mass, in the absence of aerodynamic drag. During Apollo 15's return trip, Command Module pilot Alfred Worden performed the first spacewalk in deep space when he retrieved film cartridges from the service module. Apollo 15 also caused controversy back on Earth when it was revealed the crew had each carried postal covers to the moon in exchange for about $7,000 each, despite not running it by NASA first. This violated NASA's strict policy against commercial exploitation of the U.S. government's space program, and the crew was consequently barred from future space missions. Apollo 16 returned the largest moon rock ever collected, dubbed Big Muley, weighing in at 11.7 kilograms. The mission also captured this stunning image of the lunar module's ascent. The only night launch of a Saturn V rocket occurred during the Apollo 17 mission, which lifted off on December 7, 1972. Five mice, nicknamed by the crew as Fee, Fi, Fo, Fum, and Fooey, were aboard the mission to study the effects of cosmic rays on living organisms, with the results suggesting that the rays were not harmful. The mission broke several crewed spaceflight records, including the longest moon landing, with lunar surface extravehicular activities totaling 22 hours and 4 minutes. The mission also captured one of the most famous photographs ever taken, the Blue Marble. By the time Apollo 17 had landed on the lunar surface, public support for the Apollo program was wavering. In many American eyes, the space race was seen as won, and more pressing matters at home were higher up on the public spending agenda. While most Americans were proud of their nation's achievements in space exploration, only once during the late 1960s did polls indicate that a majority of Americans favored doing more in space as opposed to doing less. By 1973, 59% of those polled favored cutting spending on space exploration, and so the Apollo program was canceled. The Apollo program was a massive undertaking, representing the largest research and development project in peacetime. At its peak, it employed over 400,000 people around the country and accounted for more than half of NASA's total spending in the 1960s. However, NASA's budget could not sustain the Apollo missions while simultaneously developing the space shuttle. NASA contracted to have 15 flight-worthy Saturn V rockets produced. Apollo 17 achieved the last lunar landing with the 12th Saturn V, leaving 3 for subsequent landings. With the cancellation of the program in 1973, Apollo 18, 19, and 20 would not go ahead as planned, and the last Saturn V launch was on May 14, 1973, when Skylab was put into orbit atop the repurposed rocket. Other hardware from the Apollo program was used for the Apollo-Soyuz mission in July 1975. Millions of people from around the world tuned in as a United States Apollo module docked with a Soviet Union Soyuz capsule, and the crew greeted one another in space. This moment is generally considered to mark the end of the space race, which had begun 2 decades previously in 1957 with the launch of Sputnik 1. Apollo set several major human spaceflight milestones. It stands alone in sending crewed missions beyond low Earth orbit. Apollo 8 was the first crewed spacecraft to orbit another celestial body, and Apollo 11 was the first crewed spacecraft to land humans on one. In total, 80 hours and 23 minutes were spent on the lunar surface by 12 Apollo astronauts over 6 successful missions. The program returned 382 kilograms of moon rocks and soil to Earth, greatly contributing to the understanding of the moon's composition and geological history. Included in these samples was the Genesis rock collected by Apollo 15 in 1971, which was dated at around 4 billion years old, making it older than the moon itself. The program laid the foundation for NASA's subsequent human spaceflight capability and funded construction of its Johnson Space Center and Kennedy Space Center. Apollo also spurred advances in many areas of technology incidental to rocketry and human spaceflight, including avionics, telecommunications, and computers. Notable innovations include cordless power tools, fireproof materials, heart monitors, solar panels, and digital imaging such as MRI and CAT scans. As Gene Cernan climbed into Apollo 17's lunar module on December 14, 1972, he became the last person to walk on the moon. Nearly half a century on, the future looks bright for lunar exploration. Under current plans, NASA aims to send a crewed mission back to the lunar surface in 2024 with the Artemis program. Artemis 1 is due to launch in the latter half of 2021, where it will test the flight systems on an uncrewed mission. Artemis 2 will launch to lunar orbit in 2023, making it the first crewed spacecraft to travel beyond low Earth orbit since Apollo 17 in 1972. Then finally, Artemis 3 will launch in October 2024, aiming to put boots back on lunar ground. The program aims to establish a sustainable presence on the moon, laying the foundation for private companies to build a lunar economy and eventually send humans on towards Mars, a fitting next step for the future of space exploration. Thanks for watching, Elder Fox. Remember to subscribe and hit the bell to keep up to date with the latest discoveries.